Hello, I'm Chris Grenade from the Quantum Architectures and Computation Group here at Microsoft, and today I'll be talking about the Quantum Development Kit, our recent effort to empower people to get hands-on and learning with quantum programming and at a high level. There's a number of different pieces of the Quantum Development Kit, including comprehensive documentation to help you get started, but the most exciting piece is Q-Sharp, our new language for thinking about quantum algorithms at a high level. So let's go on and get started. Q-Sharp is should at some level be a familiar language. We can break things down into operations, functions, namespaces, other elements that are familiar from other languages. So for instance, if we want to run a hello world, we can do that by using the message function to print out to a console, and once we have that, we can use that from C# and Visual Studio in a manner very similar to how you might send code to a GPU or an FPGA as an accelerator. Here we'll ask for a target machine, a quantum simulator, that is something running locally on our desktop that simulates how an ideal quantum computer would work for small numbers of qubits, up to about 30. And we can ask our target machine, our quantum simulator, to go and run our new operation and wait for the answer back. So if we do that, we'll see a hello world just as we expect. So it's a good hands-on way to get started with. Of course, a quantum programming language wouldn't be very interesting or useful if you couldn't allocate qubits. So let's do that. We can allocate a new qubit. We can use what's called a Hadamard operation to prepare a superposition state on that new qubit. And then if we were to measure it, we'll get 50-50 statistics out between a 0 or a 1 outcome. So that makes a good random number generator. So let's simulate how that would work. We'll allocate a qubit, apply a Hadamard, measure the result, and then that's a result we can return back out to the classical world. Once we have that, it's very similar at the C# level. We can save out the result from having run our new operation into a variable. We can loop over, we can print it to a console, we can do whatever we like with it at that point, giving us a very flexible way of interacting with this new quantum routine. So let's run it and see what we get. So we get about the 50-50 statistics we'd expect out of that, showing that that operates the way we'd expect. We can build on that and do even more by using the other operations built into Q-Sharp, such as the controlled not operation, to prepare entangled states instead of simply superposition states on the single qubit. So now we'll allocate two qubits, apply Hadamard to the first, prepare superposition, and then make an entangled pair using the controlled not operation I mentioned earlier. Now when we measure, we know that because they're entangled, we'll get the same answer on both qubits. So we'll return that out to the classical world, call it from C# in the same fashion. And again, we get the same kinds of 50-50 stats we expect, except now correlated between the two, thanks to that entanglement. We can also run in Visual Studio Code on not only Windows, but also macOS and Linux. So let's look at using the elements that we just saw in Visual Studio here to build up something that's actually a really useful quantum building block as we look at other algorithms. So in particular, let's start with teleportation. That's a little bit of a whimsical name, but it really points to a very basic building block that gets used in a lot of different contexts within quantum programming as a way to move information around a quantum device. So we can write out the same things we did earlier of a Hadamard and a controlled not to prepare some entanglement. We'll do the opposite to unprepare some entanglement to make a measurement that lets us move that information. We'll then apply a correction based on that measurement, and we can use standard classical techniques such as unit testing to build up confidence that we actually did what we intended to do here and actually moved information correctly. So let's run that. Here we can run it using the .NET Core SDK, the same way we'd run anything else with C# or F# on your favorite operating system. And when we run that, we get that the state was teleported successfully. But this somehow it feels a little bit unsatisfying as an ending point, because I had to list out each of the individual operations. And that's great if you understand deeply what each of those do, but it really isn't speaking to how do we get hands-on thinking at a high level about quantum algorithms. So instead, Q-sharp lets us do something else, which is extract those into a new operation, document them, and say it, give a name to those patterns that occur in quantum programming, the same way that we might refactor code classically. And now, instead of listing Hadamard CNOT, I say prepare some entanglement. And now the description of teleportation, so it reads more logically in terms of what we're trying to implement, rather than how we're trying to implement. So now I can say prepare an entangled pair. Adjoint says to unprepare, so that we can use that preparation as a measurement. We can then apply the correction and call this operation to do teleportation as a library routine for a particular state that we want to send. And I can run that in the same way, and I'll see that it succeeds for the exact same reason. And once we have these kinds of building blocks, we can use them to do some really neat things. So for instance, if you're interested in chemistry, a problem you might want to ask is, given some Hamiltonian that describes a particular chemical system, what is the ground state of that Hamiltonian? And what is the ground state energy? This is something that determines a lot of different properties, such as reaction rates. And so it's really interesting in a lot of different chemistry applications. So let's start with a simple H2 molecule where we can compare to theory, and we'll describe the initial state of a simulation of that molecule. Each step of a simulation, the initial state of that simulation, and the classical techniques, statistical techniques we'll use to extract information about the ground state. And I can run this in exactly the same sense as I ran all of the basic building blocks we saw earlier using the .NET Core SDK. And we'll see a plot that compares what we infer the ground state energy to be from a quantum simulation to what we know from theory for this simple molecule, giving us some confidence again that we've built up the simulation in a useful way. So these are some of the things you can do with a quantum development kit. And to try and make, and it's all powered by a large set of open source libraries that form the standard library that you can download, look at, see how they work, peel back the layers, and also contribute to. We're very thankful to the Q-sharp community for many of the contributions we've gotten back into the standard library. And you can always look and see how, for instance, state preparation for arbitrary states is defined by looking at the Q-sharp source code in the standard libraries. To try and help make it easier to get hands-on and learn, whether you're new to quantum entirely or whether you're a quantum researcher looking to branch into more programming-based efforts, we've recently also released a set of what we call katas, or self-paced exercises to teach different concepts in quantum programming, starting from what are the basic operations available to a quantum programming and ranging through more advanced topics such as how do you represent classical functions as oracles or subroutines in a quantum program. So we really hope you'll give it a try, and we look forward to your feedback. Thank you very much.